Thanks to everyone for coming. I'm Kathleen Hicks. I direct the International Security Program at CSIS, and I also have the pleasure of running the Smart Women, Smart Power Initiative along with many of my colleagues here at CSIS who make this program possible. I am going to get off the stage and invite up Candy Wolf, who is joining us from Citigroup and Citicorp, and she is the wonderful sponsor of our program. And without further ado, Candy, please come on up and give us a few remarks.
Little lack of gracefulness there. I'm trying to get up with no steps. Well, welcome, and thank you for coming through what was rain to begin with. I'd want to welcome everyone to our sixth event. This is our sixth in the Smart Women's Smart Power series. And as Citi, we've been proud to sponsor events that have showcased so many strong women leaders on this stage, and tonight is no exception. And it's exciting for me to be able to help to speak at this particular event because I had the privilege of working with Fran at the White House for a number of years when we were both working for then President George W. Bush. And a new era of terrorism was shepherded in with the 9/11 attacks. And Fran spent her tenure at the White House in the most grueling of jobs. First as Deputy National Security Advisor for Combating Terrorism, and then as the President's Advisor on Homeland Security and Counterterrorism. And she chaired the Homeland Security Council. So, you know, when I look back in a world where we have to be right every time and the terrorists only have to be right once, I'm not sure how Fran ever slept at night, or if she did, frankly, because I'm not sure in many of those days that you did. But I always felt we were safer with Fran in the sit room. Terrorism continues to evolve beyond our physical attacks, and one of the largest dangers to our welfare is cyber terrorism. And a company like Citi, which is the world's most global bank with operations in more than 100 countries, the threat of cyber attack keeps many of us up at night and certainly keeps our CEO up at night, whether in the form of crippling malware on our systems or the threat of sensitive client data. Cyber terrorists, whether they're hacktivists, state-sponsored nations, or simply criminals, present a growing and grave threat that will keep the business community and experts like Fran busy for the foreseeable future. So I want to thank all of you for coming, and Fran, thank you for taking time out and for joining all of us on what is going to be a very relevant discussion. And thank you, Nina, always, for hosting these. I know it'll be a really lively discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Candy. Just a quick note on our social media. You can follow us on Twitter. We hope you do. We are at Smart Women. That's not too hard to remember. We also want to, as always, make sure you are subscribing to the Smart Women podcast that we have on iTunes and Smart Women iTunes U course that we have. I think we have something like 20,000 subscribers, and we have, I want to say, close to 200,000 people who have viewed at least one episode before. So please, if you're not already joining that community, please do so. We are very pleased to have Fran Townsend here with us tonight. She is currently the Executive Vice President for Worldwide Government, Legal, and Business Affairs at McAndrews M. Forbes Holding. But she, of course, spent more than two decades, as Candy noted, in public service, including time as a prosecutor and assistant district attorney in her native New York, as well as in senior positions at the Justice Department and U.S. Coast Guard before serving in the Bush 43 White House. I'm sure many of you have seen, if not all of you, Fran on CNN, where she serves as an analyst on counterterrorism and homeland security issues. And our moderator tonight, as always, is the incomparable Nina Easton, senior associate here at CSIS and also a columnist at Fortune magazine and chair of Fortune's Most Powerful Women International Summit. So without further ado, over to Nina and to Fran. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Kath. So before we get started with our incredible guest, I just wanted to reinforce the idea of listening to these podcasts. You know, Fortune is a media sponsor of this event, and we've actually been able to draw on some Fortune material to fill the podcast, or to amplify the podcast. Right now, there is a podcast up, a half-hour conversation with Zippy Livni of Israel, and I did that interview in London just two nights ago as part of our Fortune Most Powerful Women's Summit. And this interview with Fran will go up on that podcast. That's something that you can not only download, but you can share with people. We'll also have coming up on that podcast my interview, again, at the London Summit with former Prime Minister of Australia, Julia Gillard. So it's a really tremendous resource, and I encourage you all to check it out and pass it on. I'm just thrilled to have Fran here again. We've been on stage before together, and I'll tell you the circumstances momentarily. She is truly a renowned expert, and as you've heard, just really been at the center of our war on terror. But as I always like to do, I like to get to know our guest first a little bit, the big get to know you, as we like to call it. Fran grew up, she was actually the first in her family not to go to college. I mean, you hear that a lot. I'm the first in my family to go to college. She was the first in her family to go to high school.
Right, to graduate.
To graduate from high school. Talk about your parents.
So my father was a roofer, had his own business. My mom was a bookkeeper working in a construction company. And both of them were children of the Depression. They didn't have much. My father had served in World War II. Was injured, now what we would think of as PTSD, and so he suffered for his whole life.
Oh, wow.
As a post-war veteran. And neither of them had the privilege. I didn't know that my mother had not graduated from high school. She was sort of embarrassed by that, and so it wasn't until I was graduating from law school, she went back, unbeknownst to me, and got her GED.
Oh,
and
wow.
So when I graduated from law school, she finally confessed to me that she had not completed high school, but because she was embarrassed and very proud that I had gone all the way, not just to college, but to law school, that she had gone back and gotten her GED.
Was that always in the front of your mind, to go to college and to go to law school, even if that wasn't the model?
It was. I mean, there really wasn't anybody in the family. Even my mother had been an only child, my father had had two brothers. Nobody had gone on to a higher education, so my parents were absolutely thrilled. Their goal was to get me through college. I tell people, if you describe my family as middle class, you probably would have been exaggerating. so they struggled. I took lots of student loans, like many kids.
And jobs.
Right. And I got my way through college. They said, graduate school would be great, but you're on your own. And so I did that on loans. And I went knowing I wanted to go into public service. It was never about the private sector. I knew I wanted to be a prosecutor. I had been a victim of a crime in college. I had been a victim
of a crime. What kind
of a crime? In college, a guy forced his way into my room, threatened to sexually assault me. He didn't. He was obviously either on drugs or intoxicated. I sort of stalled him, and I managed to get out of the room. And he was never prosecuted, and that really made me angry.
Wow.
And I also, early in my life, had also been a victim. And so I had made up my mind that victims don't have much of a voice in the system. You know, the prosecutor represents the state, not the victim. Most people don't really appreciate that until you're a victim and you say, well, but where's my voice? And so I decided a prosecutor could be both, and I wanted to become a prosecutor. So I was one of the few people in my class. I went to law school to become a prosecutor, and I knew that.
That's so interesting. And then you went on with a prosecutor's career, mm-hmm. the Southern District of New York, which is, of course, you know, the famed Southern District of New York. And then you went to the Justice Department. Mm-hmm. You prosecuted white-collar criminals and international criminal organizations. And I was curious, and then you, of course, went on to fight terror or terrorists. Aside from ideologies, there's the obvious difference between the two classes of criminals in that one has a driving ideology. Did you see common characteristics between your criminals that you were dealing with here and the terrorists that we fight overseas today?
Yeah, you know, it was interesting. When I was still in the U.S. Attorney's Office, it had been during the period in the Southern District of Mayor Giuliani, then the U.S. Attorney, to use the RICO, racketeering influenced corrupt organizations, that statute to prosecute the mafia. And the theory there was these were much more structured organizations, although gang-like, they did have a hierarchy. And so you could use the RICO statute to prosecute the mafia. And that was not so dissimilar as we saw the rise of terrorism. I'd wound up, you know, working when I went down to Main Justice, whether it was the East Africa Embassy bombings, the USS Cole bombing, all prior to 9/11. And we realized that the Al-Qaeda at the time was a much more structured organization. And so while the ideologies were quite different, you could use the same investigative techniques, the same theories in terms of a prosecution as we had used against the mafia. It wasn't so different from a prosecutor's point of view.
Was this pre-9/11?
Pre-9/11.
And so in the 90s, you were looking at, for the Justice Department and the Coast Guard at that
point? At that point, I was at the Justice Department. I had come down, I worked as the Chief of Staff in the Criminal Division. I then went on to head the Office of International Affairs. And so interestingly enough, it was sort of a logical progression. So I was prosecuting in the Southern District large international organizations. I come down to Main Justice, having gotten international experience. I understood the importance of tools in the international environment to a domestic prosecution, and so I headed that unit that allowed the exchange of evidence. I then moved on to sort of a higher level in the Criminal Division. I was an acting Deputy Assistant Attorney General, where I was responsible not just for the unit I had run, but for international training. You know, we think of not yet Commissioner Ray Kelly going down to Haiti and training the police forces. We understood that internationally having cooperative relationships with law enforcement was very important. Mm. Louis Freeh at that point in time at the FBI was deploying LEGATs. And so I moved, once you're in the international arena, you kind of naturally begin to bump up against the intelligence community. Mm. I then moved to run the unit. It was at that time, the acronym was OIPR, the Office of Intelligence and Policy Review. It's now the National Security Division in the Justice Department that's responsible for the FISA wiretaps. And so I was running the intelligence unit at the Justice Department. At that point, we also reviewed covert action. We worked with the Office of Legal Counsel to review covert action. And so I became very involved with the intelligence community as well.
And you did intelligence for the Coast Guard as well.
I did. So President Bush was elected. There was Attorney General Ashcroft came in, and I decided it was time for me. I was one of the few career people who was a direct report to the Attorney General. I decided it was time for me to think about actually running an intelligence operation as opposed to giving legal advice to others about how to do it. The Coast Guard intelligence capability at that time was really focused on drug queuing. So in the Pacific and in the Caribbean, the interdiction of narcotics on the water. But they didn't have a real intelligence operation. 9/11, I literally got there. Gosh, great story. So a woman's story. I go for my interview. I'm about 7.5 months pregnant, and I sit on a couch that I have trouble getting up from at the end of the interview because it was so low. The Coast Guard didn't have a whole lot of senior women. They hire me. I start very late August 2001, and literally 2 days later, I give birth to my second son. So I call in, and I'm not coming in. It's the end of August. And I'm not home sort of, you know, less than 2 weeks with my infant when 9/11 happens. Wow. And God bless, this is when you're grateful your mother has come down to help, because I hand off this brand new infant and I go back to work, initially part-time and then full-time in the aftermath of 9/11. And so I'm at the Coast Guard. In that last part, that last quarter of 2001, I am crazy busy. We get the Coast Guard admitted as one of the 16 organizations in the United States intelligence community. So we have all sorts of authorities. We suddenly become part of the signals intelligence community, the human intelligence community where we're collecting in US ports and ports around the world. I mean, I suddenly have what we call a black classified budget. I have a unclassified budget. I'm working as part of sort of the law enforcement and Department of Homeland Security. We're getting integrated there. I also have a role in the military intelligence community. I see Tish Long here, who helped guide me through that, because that was entirely new for the Coast Guard. And we were partners with the Naval Intelligence. So it was an incredibly busy time.
Did you feel like you had a map, a direction where to go, or did it
The most wonderful thing about this was there was no map. It was a complete blank slate.
Yeah.
So I could make anything I wanted to. And by the way, nobody at the Coast Guard understood the intelligence community, so they couldn't even supervise me.
Yeah.
It was fabulous.
Yes.
It was just fabulous. So I could make it up, right? And it was really, and so it was incredibly important because lo and behold, at that point, the Coast Guard is part of the department initially of transportation. So Secretary Norm Mineta suddenly finds he's in these national security meetings and somebody says, well, who's responsible for port security in the United States? Nobody raises their hand and they point to Norm Mineta and said, we think that's you because you've got the Coast Guard. Next thing I know, I'm in the White House Situation Room.
Port security.
Exactly, because we had the capability.
Huge.
Right. Only because we were the only people with the capability to do it.
So then you end up in the White House. How did that happen?
So again, I often tell young people it's about relationships and the people you work with. When I had been at the Justice Department, the deputy director of the CIA had been a general, an Air Force general named John Gordon. Fast forward many years, and at the time I'm over at the Coast Guard, who is the deputy national security advisor at the White House for combating terrorism, but General John Gordon. And so suddenly I show up there and we know each other, we've worked together. And when Tom Ridge leaves the West Wing as the first Homeland Security advisor to go over to run the Department of Homeland Security, John Gordon is promoted to replace Tom Ridge in the West Wing. And there's an opening at the White House. And John Gordon is asked, well, who should do that by Condi Rice as National Security Advisor? And he said, I know the perfect person who's worked all these terrorism investigations. She knows the interagency. And by the way, she's now the person you look to for port security. So I was invited in to come in for an interview. A quick side note, I'm at the Coast Guard. I'm at lunch, I come back, and there is a voicemail from a Dr. Rice to call. And of course, like most women, I've gone back to work very quickly after my second child. And I've not done any of the follow-up doctor's appointments, and I'm getting harangued at home. And so I get this voicemail, and I think, oh my God. So I call my husband at his office, and I say, I can't believe you've got some strange doctor calling me to go for my GYN appointment. Needless to say, I realize, oh, it's that Dr. Rice. She's had great fun, by the way, saying that I'm the only person who ever thought she was a GYN.
So you end up in the White House, and you will go on to become the third Homeland Security Advisor, the only woman that did that. There was a good question raised earlier. Did you lose sleep?
I did. It's one of those things you feel the burden of responsibility. You know, oh my God, not on my watch. Let nothing happen to the country, to my fellow citizens. But you also have, on the other hand, a great sense of calm. I had no doubt that I was doing everything humanly possible to try and ensure that that didn't happen. Look, the odds are against you. Candy said it, and I said it a bunch of times when I was in the job. I had to be right every day, and they only had to be right once. And so, but you had a great sense of comfort of that there are tens, I wasn't doing this alone, there were tens of thousands of dedicated public servants around the world working around the clock to make sure nothing happened. And I had real confidence in their passion and their commitment for the mission.
So as somebody who's been inside and seen the plumbing, basically, and knows like behind the scenes, you know, I always wonder what's going on in those tunnels in New York, you know. You always hear about sort of a New York-based CIA. But what was the most important thing that's happened to protect this country since then?
You know, my proudest moment was the summer of 2007 was the liquid bomb plot. And that, what the American people didn't see, you can blame me for this crazy 3-ounce rule that we still live with, but in leading up to the takedown, that investigation was ongoing. And every day, planes would take off from Heathrow in groups, right? So I don't remember what it is now. Let's call it a dozen planes in a window of a couple hours take off. They're all over the Atlantic for a period of time before they land in sort of a window of time along the East Coast. Those planes were taking off while we knew about the plot, while we were investigating the plot. No one would have criticized us if the minute we found out about the plot, we took it down. And right, we would have lost intelligence about the network. But if we'd taken it down, there would have been no risk to our fellow citizens. We made calculated decisions every night while you all slept about, were we going to let that whole group of planes take off? Were we satisfied we had mitigated the risk, that it was unlikely that anything could have gotten on that plane, that there was nobody on those planes that we believed wanted to do folks harm? But I will tell you, every day while those planes were in the air, you sort of held your breath. And so here's the other, so it took real courage on the part of the DNI and the Secretary of Homeland Security and FBI director and the CIA director to say, yes, my recommendation to the president is we got to let this investigation keep going. Because we all knew if we were wrong and those planes had exploded, we at best we were all fired. At worst we were going to be, you know, we were going to be publicly excoriated. And during that time, you never think there may be a personal element. So the deputy press secretary and her husband were going to get on one of those planes. The deputy national security advisor's daughter was coming home. And there's a no double standard rule. Unless we were willing to make it public, none of us could take personal actions based on the classified information to change our plans, because that would have been a violation of no double standard. So these weren't just policy and operational decisions we were making. They had a very human aspect to it. And we made those right decisions anyway in the best interests of the country. But I was really proud as I looked around the table and said, you know, every one of these people could have made a different personal decision because they wouldn't have been criticized.
So what did you learn about how to make a judgment call in that kind of really high wire situation?
You know, it's interesting because I think, you know, we sort of say, what does your gut say? But I will tell you, it got to a point, and that's really, what is your experience telling you, right? I can't tell you how many times Condi Rice or Steve Hadley would come down to my little office, it's got a low ceiling, it's a skiff in the bottom floor of the West Wing, and say, what does your gut tell you about this plot, the intelligence we're seeing? And the answer is, you really did have to, based on your experience, make judgment calls that had life and death consequences if you were wrong. I depended tremendously on incredible career professionals like John McLaughlin, who had been the deputy of CIA, George Tenet. I mean, these were people who had been doing it for years and would have a sense about the sourcing of the information. Keith Alexander was already at NSA, asking him what he was seeing, and Bob Mueller, what were we looking at domestically? And so when you began to stitch together those pieces of the mosaic, you had more confidence about the decisions and recommendations you were making.
Due diligence.
Yes.
So let's fast forward to the situation now. You and I last shared a stage at a Fortune dinner at the State Department. And it was within days, I think it was 24 hours after bin Laden's death had been made public. Talk about a timely guest. Although, as I told you in the green room, we were frantic that we were going to lose you to CNN in any minute. But now, of course, this week, the latest news is the killing of a top al-Qaeda lieutenant in Yemen. How important is that?
He was the individual, the al-Qaeda AQAP leader killed in Yemen this week was incredibly strategic. I mean, he's not just an individual node that's been taken out. This is the guy who was helping and inspiring and working on developing sort of the new bombing techniques to evade detection. You know, he was one of the leaders who was behind the computer cartridge bomb, the vest bomb, the underwear bomb. These were all designed to try and evade US and international bomb detection equipment. And so taking him out has a huge disruptive effect beyond just the one individual. It clearly could not have been done by US intelligence alone. We had to have been working with our partners, although I don't read the intelligence anymore, but it's not possible we could have done it alone. And so I think it's really very much to the credit of the intelligence community, the CIA, and its international partners that they were able to do it. He had been on target for a long time.
That's interesting because there's also a sensibility that you take out somebody like this and somebody replaces him, but you're saying that he had such expertise and such ability to evade our protections that it was worth,
right?
I mean, it was valuable.
Absolutely, yeah. Beyond just, he was more than just a single individual. He was a very important node in the organization. And so it's a strategic win for the United States, and it's a strategic liability for al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula.
So what do you think about this drone strategy?
Look, you know, this is, we saw the rise of it throughout the Bush administration, and then the current administration, the Obama administration, took it to a whole new level. But everybody, I think it's fair to say, believed that the trajectory of the drone program was not going to continue forever. You were going to get to a point where it would drop off because you were always doing a cost-benefit analysis. The hit in Yemen is a tremendous, I mean, I don't begin to say who takes responsibility for the drone hit, but you look at that kind of a drone hit, it was a signature strike that was reported in the Washington Post, and there had been a big debate about the value of those, and yet you see something so strategically significant and say, we're gonna have to be able to make judgments about when is that worth the risk. We are no longer in an upward tick, I think, for the drone program. I think now you must make very calculated decisions about the cost-benefit analysis of making these strikes. This one was clearly worth it, but often it's not quite as clear, and you're gonna rely on folks inside the intelligence community to make recommendations to the executive branch.
Now, of course, we've got the rise of ISIS as well, and you've got these, you've got a range of terror groups now, and when you look at ISIS and al-Qaeda, they're actually quite different. I mean, ISIS is really about controlling territory, and as I understand it, takes a very different approach to the local population than al-Qaeda does. Can you talk about the differences?
I think in that sense that ISIS is a much more dangerous enemy. So al-Qaeda, the caliphate, was this notional esoteric idea for al-Qaeda. For ISIS, it's a real territorial thing. And the fact that they have established territorial superiority in places and in a large swath of territory makes them an easy military target for a real capable adversary like the United States. But it also creates a sense of urgency and a sense of reality that they actually have the ability to control a caliphate where al-Qaeda was sort of aspiring to it. Al-Qaeda tried to mobilize their forces against the far enemy. They made sort of the targeting of the entire Muslim population sort of the driving force so that others would attack the West, and they said the West was the enemy. ISIS has a near enemy. They're attacking in local populations, local governments, so they can take control. So ISIS has got this reality. So al-Qaeda was a war of attrition. They wanted to bleed the West economically and bleed our forces, kill our forces. ISIS has got a strategy of acceleration. They get momentum from their killing inside the caliphate area and territory that they're protecting. So it's a quite different strategy. I worry because you've seen this bleeding effect. You know, we used to call it the ink blot strategy. If you think of ink hitting a page and it's seeping out, we see the acceleration of ISIS in places like Afghanistan, where they've recently just killed police officers, in Yemen, in Libya. We see them in Lebanon. I mean, there's this real bleeding strategy. There are areas in Saudi Arabia where they've raised the ISIS flag. This is really, really dangerous. When you think of the potential for ISIS in a place like Pakistan that has a nuclear program, I think we've got to take ISIS incredibly seriously and worry that we haven't shown that we have a strategy that will be effective against it.
You mentioned Saudi Arabia, which some would argue has a mixed record on the terror front, certainly in some of the messages that come out of its religious sector. Do you think this is going to change the approach of Saudis and others towards terror groups?
I'll tell you, we saw in 2003 when al-Qaeda attacked the housing compounds in Saudi Arabia, Saudi Arabia really changed its approach to terror and became very active partners. I'll tell you, without Saudi Arabia, you would never have disrupted the Yemen plots, the computer cartridge, or the vest plot, those were entirely disrupted due to Saudi intelligence. So much so, the interaction between the Saudi, and I know this from foreign intelligence services, the interaction between the Saudis and the American intelligence community on the cartridge one is really instructive. So there was an exchange of information that there was this plot. American intelligence and law enforcement couldn't find the planes that those cartridges were on. The Saudis really were so concerned, they risked burning their source, and they provided the bills of lading so we could find those planes and find those cartridges. And so while you can take issue with their brand of Islam and what they preach, I will tell you, as counterterrorism partners on an operational and tactical level, they rival our relationship with the British intelligence services.
That's very interesting. So going back to ISIS, and of course, as we all know, a big one reason we're especially fearful of them is their ability to recruit globally. And let me start with this piece first, the woman piece. It's very interesting that they've been able to appeal to women, both as kind of come over and marry somebody who will be a martyr and that enhances your status, or they find ways to appeal to them through Saudi Arabia, through social media. And I was in London this week, and the top of the news, of course, was those three women who had gone with their 9 children to Saudi Arabia on a religious excursion and then ended up going, we believe, to Syria. Two of the fathers were weeping on air every night. What do you make of ISIS's ability to attract women?
You know, it's interesting. Al-Qaeda didn't sort of actively go out and recruit women in such a public way. What I find interesting about ISIS is it's not only that you can come and be a wife to a fighter, and that that is a noble role, that you can give him children, you can be part of the caliphate. They also recruit them actively as operators. You'll see videos all over the internet of women in ISIS who are actually being militarily trained to fight. It's interesting because it sort of, in many ways, takes advantage of what is a tactical vulnerability for the West. My sons have been raised to hold doors and to think of women as, while obviously they've got a very strong mother, very capable, but to honor women. And so in some ways, they've decided clearly ISIS, while they take a dim view of the role of women, they understand that operationally that there is also a role for them and that that is leverage that they can use.
What do you think is the foremost way to fight these recruitment efforts?
Look,
men or women?
Right. There are two, in my judgment, there are two major pillars to this. One is you have to deny them that battle space that they use, and that's the internet, by and large, and communications. But you also then have to fill that with something, right? And that's the counter-narrative piece. I will tell you, it is a frustration. No administration has been particularly good at the counter-narrative. I've come to really believe, having spoken to folks around the world, there's a movement in London, not in my name, which is quite active. I think as a government, we have to make up our minds. We are never going to be good at this, not because we don't want to be, but we ought to have mechanisms by which we can fund it and not control the content for those who will create the counter-narrative, mm-hmm. like folks like Not In My Name. But I don't. The State Department effort has been, you know, not very effective and
right.
not very good, and that's not a criticism of this administration. None of us have been right. very good at it. And so I think we got to accept that we're not good at it and have others do it outside of government. On the denying them the battle space, that's where government can and should be better at it. That's where the government must work with the private sector. We are blessed with a First Amendment freedom of speech, but that doesn't mean that all speech is permissible. And so there have got to be rules and an understanding about what is unacceptable.
Give me an example.
Okay, so beheading videos are not protected First Amendment speech. They just aren't. And so the notion that Western companies and social media platforms can be used to distribute this sort of trash that is very much key to our adversaries' recruitment is ridiculous. Mm-hmm. And so we've got to find ways, and we've got to work with government and private sector to deny them the battle space and get that stuff off.
What's your counter-extremism project?
So the counter-extremism project I launched, it was around the UN General Assembly last year, along with Ambassador Mark Wallace, who had served in the UN during the Bush administration, and Senator Joe Lieberman. And that was all about denying them social media platforms, whether it was YouTube or there's a thing called ManBarMe. There's all sorts of sort of dark web programs and Twitter. And get that stuff off. I will tell you, it has been, we now have been enormously successful. It was very frustrating because Twitter wouldn't engage. It wasn't, I was happy to have a dialogue and disagree, but they wouldn't even engage with us. And so we began to take this campaign, we called it the CEP, Counter-Extremism Project Digital Disruption, where we named and shamed. And we would go out, and we did it both in our public account, that is the CEP Twitter account, and I did it in my personal account. The problem, and ultimately we have been reasonably effective at denying them this battle space. We also talk to companies when we find that companies inadvertently have supported the transfer of goods or money to ISIS or a terrorist group. The problem with doing it in an individual capacity is ISIS then targeted me and was threatening me with beheading. And so what you find is the government's got to take responsibility for helping to deny them the battle space, and then nonprofits and others can come in to assist them. But it's real hard to do just from the private sector standpoint.
So looking at two other fronts, and that's one front on this on war on terror. The other front, of course, is military. We talked a bit about drones. Do you think that the war on terror in the Middle East and against ISIS in particular, although Al-Qaeda too, can that be done with that boots on the ground to a much larger extent than it is now?
So we can't fight the battles on behalf of of all the other countries in the Middle East. But I think what we're seeing now is an unprecedented commitment on the part of our Arab allies, Saudi Arabia, UAE, Bahrain. I mean, they now have skin in the game, which was the big complaint, and I think rightly so, for decades, that we were fighting this war, and they were the beneficiaries. They would provide funding, they would provide intelligence support, but they were not providing military support. They're doing that now. But just like we couldn't be successful alone, I don't think it's fair to think they're going to be successful alone. And so I do think that we need some number of military advisors and trainers to be able to be there to help them with targeting, intelligence, and logistics support. I think you can expect that sort of Afghan forces who've relied on the American military, for example, for air support, airlift support, to be successful without us being there. The Iraqi military's performance has been disappointing, but I think, on the other hand, a lack of an American commitment to them, including air support and advisors, can't be sort of dismissed either. And so I think on both sides, we've gone from one extreme mm-hmm. of having tens of thousands of boots on the ground to having none. And I think somewhere in between there, in terms of military support to our allies, is the right answer.
One country people really haven't focused on that seems like it could be a way to suck in American military is Libya, mm-hmm. Which is becoming a failed state and to some extent a transit way for ISIS and being quite close to Italy, for example.
Right.
What are your thoughts on Libya?
So, I mean, look, this is, during the Bush administration, we had been criticized for failing in phase four operations. That is, the come in behind the military operation and build civilian institutions. So I was slack-jawed, frankly. I had been in Libya about 10 days before the Benghazi attack that killed Chris Stevens. I'd been with Chris Stevens. And I was slack-jawed to see a failure of phase four operations in Libya. That was a coalition effort. I think it was very well executed. But the fact remained, we had to help organize not just the military campaign, but phase four operations. And so Libya is another example of losing
the peace.
What
was the failure exactly?
Well, this is, once the military operation, Gaddafi fell, it was clear that the government was having trouble getting on its feet. And frankly, it needed security assistance and security training and support. You needed institution building for political parties. There was a whole series of things like that sort of phase four, typical phase four operation that we lost our attention.
On.
We did, because at that point, if you remember at that point, Syria was falling apart and Syria was in sort of complete demise. It raises the other issue, frankly, that we ought to talk about. We have the largest refugee crisis mm-hmm. since World War II. Yeah. Millions upon millions of internally displaced persons. It's around the world, including Africa, but the area that concerns me the most, more than 11 million displaced persons in Syria. That is the recruiting pool for Al-Qaeda and ISIS for the coming generations. Our children and our children's mm-hmm. children will be fighting the next wave of terror that's going to come out of those displaced person populations with children who have watched their fathers slaughtered, their mothers mm-hmm. abused sexually and otherwise, and while the West stood by. And I will tell you, if you're not persuaded by the absolutely tragic humanitarian crisis that's caused by the displaced persons, there is a national security threat.
Wanted to ask you on another front, and then we'll turn to the audience. Another front in the war on terror is, of course, intelligence gathering. How important is NSA bulk data collection?
So, you know, it's funny that the media, put me in that group.
You are the media.
Right, I know.
To some extent.
So put me in that group. But the media has focused sort of obsessively about the point to a case where it disrupted a plot. And what I would say to you in my experience was it was one of those programs that provided a mosaic. The mosaic alone didn't paint the picture, but I needed all the points. Sometimes the points that you got was the absence of data, right? That you learned something from that. And so you can't underestimate that. The other piece to that was you got roving wiretaps. You got the ability to get subpoena information in bulk. There were other ways without wholesale doing away with the program that you could have put controls around it and had judicial oversight, it seemed to me, as a way of ensuring the privacy, civil liberties, and due process concerns, and I understand those, without wholesale doing away with it. The problem with that is in the absolutely polarized political environment that has become Washington, I was saying before we came in here, you can no longer disagree without being disagreeable, which I find frustrating.
Yeah.
It's very hard, it seems, here to have a real conversation about the substance without getting political.
And it's one of those things both parties were on the same page on not all that long ago. Mm-hmm. Questions, and when I questions meaning it needs to end in a question mark, it needs to be short, and please identify yourself. Identify yourself.
Julia Yu with Citigroup. I was just wondering, what are your views on the effectiveness of the proposed agreement between the P5 plus one and Iran in terms of stopping Iran's development of a nuclear weapon and in terms of cooling other Middle Eastern countries' interest in developing a nuclear weapon?
And I want to hear that, and I actually have to interject too, because I didn't ask you a key question we wanted to talk about, which was you believe in Iranian regime change, and you've been involved in some activities recently promoting that. So can you talk about that as well as that?
Sure.
That was a very good question. Thank you.
So let me start with, let's set a little bit of context, because I think my views are informed by this. One, the Iranian regime is illegally holding at least four Americans, including a journalist, including a retired FBI agent, and a United States Marine, and we get no information and we don't know the whereabouts or the well-being of those people, and they're not treated fairly. They don't have access to consular affairs. I mean, it is abhorrent. They are the single largest state sponsor of terror in Hezbollah. Yes, not every country in the world views Hezbollah as a terrorist organization, having killed Jews in Argentina and Americans in Lebanon. Let's agree, in this country, they are viewed as a terrorist organization and they're the single largest state sponsor. You take that and you take the likelihood of any sort of nuclear material to me, which means you've increased the likelihood of an improvised nuclear device, and I say, you can't go there. So these negotiations start from a premise that we're going to deny them a nuclear weapons capability. And it seems to me we have now backed ourselves into not will they have that, but how large will it be, what will the breakout period be. We've gone a very far way down that path of allowing them sufficient capability that they will be a danger to the region and to the United States, and they continue to call for the destruction of our single democratic ally in the region, which is Israel. So I got real problems, as you can tell, with the current structure as we understand it of the agreement. So I am pessimistic that it is possible to cut any deal that is not a bad deal at this point. Having said all that, in fairness, I think we've got to wait to see what does the deal look like. I do think Congress is right to say that they have a right to review this deal and have a say on it. In fairness now to the administration, many times you will do an agreement that is not a treaty that requires Senate approval. I don't think the administration did a very good job in explaining the difference about what's an agreement and what's a treaty and why. Sometimes you want an agreement because you don't want to be bound by it. I think they would have done well to explain that and to talk to the Senate. But I do think that Congress, given where we are right now, the Senate has a right, and I think that the Senate Foreign Relations Committee is right to say, we are going to take a look at this and hold hearings, and then they're going to have to go through the process and see whether or not they can get a veto-proof majority on it if it's not a good deal.
Regime change.
Look, I think that the Iranian people have an absolute right to have their voices heard. I think it is unfortunate that when, in the beginning of the Obama administration, when there was a democratic movement in Iran, we were not supportive in the same way that we were in Egypt. Because I think that if we had breathed some air and life into it, they would have had that opportunity. I don't believe that women should be treated the way they are in Iran. I don't believe that women should be treated anywhere in the world the way they are in a large swath of the Arab countries. And so I believe that if the Iranian people had the democratic ability to go to the polls without fear and without favor, you would see quite a different Iran. And you would see an Iran that much more resembled decades earlier when women were a part of the population, where they weren't controlled. And I think that sense of freedom is far more important than Iran having nuclear weapons.
But that's also very provocative. View and what talk about specifically what kind of policies you have been involved in.
So I have spoken in front of, along with, by the way, the most fascinating thing about this is when I speak to this group, the National Council for Resistance in Iran. Previously, it was the MEK. MEK had been a terrorist group, had renounced violence, had cooperated when I was in the Bush administration in turning over intelligence information related to the Iranian regime and the Iraqi regime when it was Saddam Hussein. And so having renounced weapons, having cooperated with us, there was an agreement to take them off the terrorism list. That didn't happen until this administration. They were taken off the list. They are one aspect of the Iranian opposition. They are an Iranian opposition group that believes in democratic principles, does not believe Iran should have a nuclear weapon, believes women should be able to vote and to work, and they believe in a free press and freedom of religion. And so I have supported, Ed Rendell, the head of the DNC, Howard Dean, who had been a major spokesperson and supporter of Senator Kerry when he was running for president against President Bush when he was reelected. I mean, one of the few bipartisan efforts in this country is
Rudy Giuliani is a
part of it. General Hugh Shelton, I mean, a whole bunch of military leaders, George Casey also appeared. Bill Richardson, who had served as Secretary of Energy in the Clinton administration. I mean, it's a very interesting bipartisan view supporting Iranian democratic opposition and regime change.
That's interesting. Questions right here?
I see so many friends.
Good afternoon.
So wonderful.
Thank you so much, Nina. Thank you for your presentation. My name is Rosemary Seguero. I'm a president of an organization called Hope for Tomorrow. We focus on conflicts and violence prevention. I was in Kenya at the time of the US bomb in 1998 and also here in 2009-11. What did you see the difference between the Kenya bombing and Tanzania bombing and the USA bombing and the other going on bombings around the world? What would you talk about them and the prevention for further bombings around the world and what happened? Thank you.
So what we did in the wake of the East Africa embassy bombings, what we understood was our installations, as we hardened targets, our installations around the world, like military bases and embassies, were very vulnerable. Why? Because they were accessible. It was easy to get to them. It was easier to get to them than it was to get into the United States. And so, I mean, I think it was a real wake-up call for law enforcement and the State Department about hardening our facilities. I'll tell you, when you harden your facilities, when you go to an embassy, a post-East Africa embassy like Baghdad, you realize that by virtue of our hardening it, we interact less with the people that were there and living among. So it's very hard for diplomats in a place like Baghdad to go out into the population to talk to sort of our allies around the world. And that's not true just in Baghdad. In many of our embassies around the world, in Pakistan, in Saudi Arabia, it's very difficult for our diplomats to get out and for local populations to get in to talk to them. We have to do that to protect our people and to prevent tragedies like Benghazi, but it comes at a tremendous cost. And so I worry about that. Our intelligence community worries about it, and so do our diplomats. They have to make a much greater effort, but there's not much choice in the world we live in, I think.
I think you had a question right here.
My name is Amin Mahmoud. I'm with the Center of Egyptian-American Relations. We have Sisi is fulfillment of Ayman al-Zawahiri prophecy, really, that military rules will never give you freedom or democracy. And being documented that Sisi commit crime against humanity, what's your advice for the United States and the EU to stop supporting military and political support to somebody? Countries look at Egypt and they been recruited to ISIS from Egypt, from Tunis, from Saudi Arabia in particular, because the attachment to Egypt, teachers and other issues. What's your advice to them to stop that? Then we can reduce the number of recruitment to ISIS.
I want to make sure I understand the question.
Yeah, I was.
What is my advice?
What's your advice to the United States administration and the EU administration to stop supporting dictator, fascist dictator, which is Sisi, documented by all human rights organizations that he commit crime against humanity?
Well, look.
And that's when encourage people to join ISIS, when they don't have any. And if you follow Egypt closer,
okay,
you will
fine.
See
okay, thank you.
People going through that.
Okay.
So, you know, this is part of the difficulty, and it doesn't matter whether it's a Republican or a Democratic administration. You are constantly balancing a whole menu, right, of foreign policy issues. The president has said we need to be true to our values, but you look at a place, whether it's Egypt, I look at the Iran negotiation. Iran has had more executions under Rouhani than at any other time, including Ahmadinejad, and yet we're sitting across the table negotiating the nuclear deal. You mentioned Egypt, but there's a constant balance, right? What is more important? We do care about human rights, but we must balance that against a whole host of other foreign policy agendas. In China, we have a tremendous foreign policy agenda with China, and it's a long list. Does that mean we don't engage with them because of their views on privacy and restrictions on the internet? No, we engage with them anyway. Sometimes that's a really painful discussion, and it's a very difficult balance. We engaged during the Bush administration with Mubarak. We pushed him on human rights issues, but we didn't stop engaging with him because we disagreed with him. I guess what I would say to you is you make this constant trade-off and this constant balance. You don't abandon your fundamental principles, but sometimes you engage with people that you don't always agree with on a broad spectrum of issues, and it's a difficult balance.
I think we have time for one more question right here in the front.
Oh my goodness, this is an old friend. Uh-oh.
Hi, Fran.
Hi, Mike.
Mike Rowles, retired FBI and now consulting on countering violent extremism. When the initiative came out of the White House 3.5 years ago, along with the implementation plan, those in and out of the government who were focused on it observed three things that haven't changed, and that it was rolled out by your successor generation, absent funding, staffing, and no one really in charge, different from how it's done elsewhere. Put yourself back in, whether you want to be the National Security Council or Justice or wherever you want to go, and think for a minute that this proposal is handed to you next week. This initiative is given to you to figure out what have we done, what haven't we done, where do we go? Where do you go?
Mike, tell me the 3 points that you mentioned. Tell me what that is.
No funding for any of the whole of government, which has really been reduced to 4 agencies now. No staffing to come along with it to implement the strategic implementation plan. And no one in the government really responsible to coordinate the overall efforts of those who do want to participate.
This is on the counter-extremism side.
Right.
Yeah.
What would you do with it?
Yeah, look, I think you've got to make it, you know, it's the old story, where you spend money is what your priorities are. You can say your priorities are countering extremism, but if you don't put the money and the staffing and the policy against it, it's not true. Well, you can say it's true, but it's not true. And so I absolutely think this is a very hard thing to matrix, right? Because you not only, what people don't appreciate is you can say I'm going to counter extremism, but you've got a diplomatic effort, you've got financial sanctions, Juan Zarate knows more about it than anybody in this room, you've got the intelligence and covert action pieces, and so it is uniquely what the White House does. There's gotta be somebody at the White House who owns it. Owning it means you are responsible for it, and you are held accountable for it, and that means ensuring that each of those agencies has the legal authorities, the resource staffing, and the money in order to execute against their responsibility. We haven't seen that. And the answer is, I found, quite frankly, the White House summit on countering extremism to be a disappointment, so much so I was invited and didn't attend. I just didn't think it had, I'm gonna give you, I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about being responsible and accountable. The President Bush had a strategy for pandemic flu. And so he did an announcement. I wound up, God help us all, I was responsible for the strategy and then assigning responsibility. We actually had what we call affectionately in government a horse blanket. Every agency had deliverables by dates. And we told the cabinet secretaries, by the way, I'm gonna go to the National Press Club and we're gonna score you. And I did it. And guess what? It got implemented, and lo and behold, when the Obama administration came in and they had to face a pandemic flu, they had a strategy. Did they make changes to that? Yes, they did. Were they absolutely grateful that they had something to work from? Yes, they did. And so when I say you need that same sort of very disciplined, organized effort in countering extremism if it's ever gonna work, and it must come from the White House. You've gotta have somebody at the White House who's responsible for it.
So we next have a question, a remote question from Lori Burtman in Louisiana. What can the average person do right now to help prevent terrorism? What's your actionable advice?
Sure. The single most important thing, you know, you've heard these, it started in New York, it's called See It, Say It. And it's really what that's a sort of tagline for is active engagement in local communities. The honest answer is it is unlikely that if there is going to be a terrorist attack inside the United States, that the federal level with its limited resources are going to know it first. Truthfully, those people may be in your communities. You've got to work with your local law enforcement, and you've got to be willing to stand up and say, I've seen this and this is unusual. This makes me uncomfortable. This is an individual who's changed his behavior. It's about having community involvement, engagement, and leadership.
I would add that too with just mass killings here, that if you had more see it, say it sensibility. So on an end note, this is a very broad question, but so we've had a lot of protective measures come into place since 9/11, yet we've also seen a morphing and an expansion of the threat. So are we safer now? How would you gauge that?
Well,
or not.
So here's the bad news. If you look just at statistics, 2014 was the deadliest year on record since they kept statistics going back to 1970. These are statistics kept by a program called START at the University of Maryland, and by a long shot, both by the number of incidents and by lethality if you look worldwide. And so I think statistically, the answer is we are absolutely in a more dangerous time than we have ever been in. Some of that is this fracturing and metastasizing of the terrorist threat around the world. The good news is you've got more capability and more resources devoted to it than we ever have. But I think we've got to be realistic. the likelihood, because now we have seen terrorists can inspire action here inside the United States without ever crossing a border, the likelihood of other incidents here inside the United States is higher than ever. On the other hand, it is less likely that it will be a mass casualty event like a 9/11 killing thousands of Americans. Does that make you feel any better? No, right? You worry. But I think we've got to be realistic. We're likely to see small-scale attacks inside the United States because they can.
Well, on that less than cheery note, but important note, this was a huge topic, and I know we just barely scratched the surface, but your insights were just incredible, and I think we all walk away a lot more educated about this. Thanks so much, Fran.
Thank you.